Good morning, viewers. Welcome back to our FB Live this Saturday. And on behalf of the Banjara family, I welcome you all once again. And today's topic is my favorite topic. Whenever Ali sits down and says, all of us sit and discuss, what are we going to be discussing next time or what should be the next FB Live? My first point or the topic in the list is assertiveness. So what is so special about this assertiveness? Why is this skill so important? So, who better than Ali to discuss this?
Very good morning to all of you. Yes, as Seema just now told you, there's a background to today's session. 3-4 months back when we started off saying that, you know, people are locked up at home. Let's keep in touch with them. Let's connect with them. Let's do something meaningful so that, you know, all the people get to learn, do a little bit of learning, little bit of entertainment, little bit of connectedness. So we started making out these topics. And the funny thing was, as she told you just now, whenever we would be sitting and discussing topics, she would say assertiveness. And I said, no, there are more important topics. People are interested in children who are locked up. We are talking about these, that, something used to go on. And every now and then, again, she would come out with, you know, assertiveness. So I realized how assertive she was. She did not push and she did not bring her way of things. And she didn't give up saying that, you know, see, I've been asking Ali, he's not taking up the topic or something. And she won. And here we are today talking about assertiveness. So you have a real life example of how this thing works. Okay. Anyway, let me just start off with first explaining that most of us, for whatever reason, our upbringing, the way we have been told by our parents, you know, that you should not be rude, you should not back answer, you should not do this. So many things have been told to us. So what happens is that many of us become what is known as passive or submissive. We don't want to raise our voice. We don't want to argue. We don't want to have conflict and this and that. There's always this feeling, you know, that what's the point in trying to argue unnecessarily? It leads to unpleasantness. And more so when it involves people whom we love or whom we care for or with whom we have to have a day-to-day interaction and things like that. The inevitable general feeling is that, you know, let's not get into unpleasantness. Why do this thing? Let us let go. So many of us keep continuously suffering because we are passive, we are submissive, you know, we don't raise up our voice, we don't correct the other person, even when the other person is saying something which is not very correct or whatever it may be. Then what happens? Some of us get fed up and then we retaliate. So what we do is we become dominating or aggressive. One fine day we say that enough is enough. Why are you all the time trying to put me down? I also have these and I don't like these and something of that sort. So the pendulum swings from one end to the other end. We get into that conflict mode. And then once that starts, you know how it is. People with whom you have to be connected every now and then, or people whom you care for or who are important to you, if you get into that conflict situation, you know what the answers are. Now, many of us say, I am not basically an angry person. I am not, you know, the type of person who likes to get into conflict and this and that. But what do I do? The other person is just not listening. I was submissive. I was giving in. I was quiet all the time, hoping that the other person will understand and will, you know, calm down and say, see, I have been so bad to this person. I have always been the, you know, loud one and the rude one and all that. And the other person has not been bad to me. So I will wake up one fine day and I'll say, you know, no, I think I should be nice to the person. That is a myth. Not only that does not happen, the other person starts presuming that that is how the way of life is and that is how I should connect with this person. I am the one who is going to shout. I am the one who is going to point out mistakes. I am the one who is going to be rude. And it is the duty of the other person to keep quiet. Or if the other person is fighting, see, the other person is also raising. So what do you mean I should not be angry or I should not be rude? Look at him or her. Other person is also doing this. So this is what happens. A third methodology which some of us use is what we call as pairing up. So we go whining, crying to a third person. See how you're being, see how even when I'm nice, you don't this. And we start expecting support from another person, which rarely comes. Or it comes in the wrong way. That person starts giving you some funny advice which is not applicable to you at all or which makes matters worse. Now you say, see, not only am I being oppressed by this person, when I sought help from another person who is important to me, whom I care for, whom I love, that other person only made matters worse for me. That means I am the victim against the whole world. You slowly start thinking that I, me versus the rest of the world, which is a very sad situation to happen. And in some of these type of situations, you know what we do? We try to run away from the situation. So there is this thing called fight or flight syndrome. We either get into fights and arguments or we want to literally run away from that situation. We don't want to even face it, hoping that it will disappear by the time I come back into it. But as you know, it doesn't. So that is when this concept of assertiveness comes in. Is it possible to create a win-win situation? When you are aggressive, it is a win-lose. I want to win at the cost of making the other person lose. When you are totally submissive and you surrender, it is a lose-win situation. I lose, I give up, you win, you do what you want. And as I told you earlier, even that does not make the person happy. Even when you're surrendering yourself completely, the other person's expectations keep going up all the time. Similarly, I need not tell you aggression always breeds further aggression in some form or the other. I know of situations where, let's say, a husband and wife are very aggressive with each other, and the aggression comes out on the child. So the child has nothing to do with the fight, but either one of them or both of them feel that I need to retaliate, I need to give back. So whom do I give it back to? I look at somebody who is a soft person, soft victim. Or I may go to my very docile mother and I may raise my voice against her, saying that, what are you sitting and watching this whole tamasha? Don't you care? This has nothing to do with it. This is also another thing that happens. Aggression and this and that makes us unpopular. Believe me, even being submissive makes us unpopular. People don't respect you. People literally look down upon you. When you complain and say that, see, he's being so rude to me, he's being so this and that. Let's say in an office, there's a boss who's very aggressive. And there's this employee, you know, who says, I don't want conflict. I don't want to get into unpleasantness. I'm letting. But when he goes to the others, thinking that they will, you know, feel nice, that he is such a sweet person and he never retaliates, they actually look down. They think of him as a useless fellow. They don't even want to make friends with such a person. And believe me, either when you're aggressive or when you're submissive, people don't feel like helping you. Nobody wants to help a submissive person because they say, when you can't fight for your rights, why should I come behind you and fight for your rights? Unless you do it, I'm not interested. The same thing, if you are getting into arguments, most people say, I don't want to take sides. No, am I not right? Isn't the other person wrong? Sorry, boss. I'm not interested in who's right and wrong. But when you are doing this unpleasantness, things, I don't want to take sides. Including, as I told you, even children. Most of the children tell their daddy and mommy, I don't want to take sides. I don't know what you are saying. I don't know who's right, who's wrong. And I don't want to know. But one thing is sure. I don't want to have too much to do with you. I want to maintain my own distance. Including the fact that if you tend to be aggressive and you retaliate, it gives you a little short-term benefit. It gives you that high, as they say, you know, it gives you that kick. I didn't listen to him. I shouted back at him or something. But the long-term things are very, very, very poor. And the same thing with passive people. You should agree and believe that you have the right to your own opinion. You have a right to contribute. You have a right to be valued. But if you are totally passive, you do not get what you want or need. You get less respect from others. And while the stress may be reduced in the short term because you avoided conflict, in the long term, it is much higher. The same thing happens with the pairing up. It weakens your self-esteem. I'm not able to handle it, so I have to go running to somebody else to help. The more I do this pairing up thing, trying to seek a third person's help, the more my self-esteem and my confidence levels go down. Third persons can make matters worse and more complicated, that I've told you. Gossip goes around. Somebody twists whatever you have to say and puts it in a different manner or something. And then the person whom you are confronted will feel offended. Why did you go and talk to so-and-so? Why did you have to bring that one into the picture? So the conflict can actually, you know, aggravate. And when you are pairing up with somebody, you are losing control over the decisions which you should have taken. And the last one, as I told you, is running away from the situation and things of that sort. That helps only for a short while if you feel it is absolutely essential. If you're in a situation where somebody is being bad to you, somebody is being aggressive, somebody is being dominating, and you're a little confused, you're not sure how to retaliate, you do not know what are the facts, and you want to be sure about what you are talking. So running away temporarily in such situations for a short while helps. That's the only thing that I recommend other than assertiveness, that if you feel that you are unprepared, ask for time. Give whatever excuse depending on the situation and the person. But ask for time. Gather your thoughts. Build your confidence. Bring down your stress levels. Collect all the data. Mentally make a sort of, you know, bullet point list in your mind saying, I'm first going to talk about this. Then I'm going to clarify. Then I'm going to ask this question. And then come back. This is how it goes. Okay. Now, let us see how this situation of what happens if take a typical, I'm just presenting to you a typical situation of husband and wife, but it could be anybody, it could be any two people who are close to each other or something. And supposing one person tends to be very aggressive and dominating all the time, what are the options for the other person? So recapping what I told you, the second person can be very submissive, hoping that this one, I'm giving you husband and wife situation. Let's say the husband is a very angry person. It could be a wife also. Okay, I'm not taking sides as far as genders are concerned. But in this particular role play, we are presuming that the husband happens to be a short-tempered and a very aggressive or a dominating person. Now, what happens if the wife is totally submissive and thinks that, you know, let me be nice to him. He will learn his lesson. He will learn to mellow down. Then what happens if the wife becomes aggressive? And finally, what happens when the wife is assertive? So here we have Sridhar, who tends to, you know, he's working hard, he's got stresses in office and this and that. He has this tendency to come and bring out his anger to his wife. So when he starts shouting at Meera, let us see what, how she responds.
Hey Meera, what you have done? What did I ask you? You are always like this, very lethargic, totally unorganized. What, you didn't even know, you don't even know that what you did or what you did not do. Always you are like this. What is that? Please tell me. How many times should I tell you?
I'm really sorry if I did something wrong. Please tell me I'm sorry.
Every time you say sorry and then you get away with it, you're making me more and more upset when you say sorry. Right?
There it is. Even when she is saying sorry, he is actually becoming more dominating. That's a funny part of it. You would think, no, that when I say sorry unconditionally, without even knowing what I've done wrong, but it doesn't work. Now what happens if Meera takes the 180 degrees opposite turn? No, I'm not going to tolerate this. What is this all the time he's shouting at me? Let me give it back to him. So what happens?
Hey Meera, come here. See, what have I done?
What did I do?
What did you do? You don't even know what you did?
Why are you shouting like this? Please don't shout.
What? If I'm angry, I will shout at you.
The maid is there at home.
So what if the maid is there?
I don't want to hear anything. I don't want to listen.
What do you want? What do you mean that you don't want to listen? You need to listen to me.
If you shout, we'll not talk.
Wow. What happened? Nothing is happening. Communication is breaking down. She's trying to protect herself. She's trying to stop him. But does he stop? It doesn't work, no? Now, haven't you seen these are actual real life situations that can happen in any family, in any office, anywhere? So we come to the final and most important thing. How can a person respond in an assertive manner? So here is Sridhar, who is very angry and very unreasonably angry, but Meera is learning how to handle it without either giving in or without being aggressive.
Hey Meera, come here, see what is that?
You seem to be a little disturbed and upset. What is it?
Certainly I am disturbed. What did I ask you and what have you done?
Can you be a little more specific, please?
I asked you for the papers. I needed it for the conference call. You are so unorganized.
No, Sridhar, I am organized most of the times. Today there has been a problem. The mail was late. Come, tell me what it is and we will do it.
First get me the papers, then we will talk about it.
Sure, come, let's talk about it.
Very simple, very almost sounding as too easy, isn't it? But it works. Maybe not as simply as what we demonstrated, but this was just to give you a quick update, no? So we sort of shortened it into the thing. But if you've understood the basic principle about the thing, but what did Meera do? She asked, you know, saying that, yes, what is it? Can you be specific? She didn't shout, she didn't run away, she didn't say sorry. She said, can you be specific? And that is what brought out Sridhar to say that the issue on which I'm getting angry is that you did not keep the papers which I had asked you to keep on my table for such a small thing. And then she also is assertive in saying that, no, I'm very organized. Today I have an issue. The maid servant came late. We had to get this children ready, something of that sort. And that is why it happened. And yet I will do it. As simple as that it does work. Being assertive increases your chances of your needs being met. We all have needs, right? We have needs, we have wants. when you're assertive, the chances of getting what you want actually improve. Being assertive helps us to be in control over our own emotions. It increases our self confidence, and at the same time, it builds confidence in the other person. Believe me, assertive people have more friends and less stress. It takes some amount of practice and some amount of continuous introspection. I'm not saying that it can be done overnight and things of that sort, but you can do it starting with simple things like, I have the right to say no. No, Sridhar, right now the maidservant has just come. Unless I go and help her, the whole dinner will get late. So I will put the papers, but not right now. If it is very urgent, you do it. Otherwise, wait till I finish with the cooking part and then I'll come and do it. I have a right not to understand. You're so stupid. Can't you understand? No, I actually didn't understand. I want you to explain that to me more clearly. I have the right to make mistakes. Generally, I'm organized. Today, yes. I had agreed to put the papers and I missed out on that because I got involved in some other domestic activity. So I have a right to make mistakes. I have a right to be listened to. Just a moment, Sridhar. Can I tell you what I feel about this situation? If you're very angry, I'll talk to you later. It doesn't matter. You calm down. But I do want you to please listen to what I have to say. I have a right to make my needs met. I have a right to contribute towards this discussion and all that. It can't be one way all the time. I have a right to my own dignity. You can't keep putting me down like this and expect me to, you know, accept whatever you are doing to me. I have a right to make my own decisions. I may also decide that doing the cooking work is more important than getting those papers and doing that work on the laptop. It's my decision. And I have the right to consideration from others. Remember that. You have to treat me as an equal human being about what I am doing. Now, this also includes, here we showed you a little role play about two adults. Sadly, we tend to take out all our aggressiveness on children. So often it happens. We just presume that we can say anything and everything to a child, and the child will only say, yes, sir, no, sir, yes, ma'am, no, ma'am, yes, papa, no, mama, I'm sorry, and all that. That is not the right way of bringing up children. There are so many of us as adults, we don't even realize when we are getting angry. So just let's have a quick look at a short, you know, role play of a teacher who seems to be, for whatever her own personal stresses are, she seems to be taking out her anger on children. And she doesn't like a child who's over-enthusiastic and who wants to answer questions and who seems to be doing well. Actually, she should be happy, no, but she isn't. She doesn't like this little child here who's always jumping up, raising her hand, saying, yes, miss, I know the answer, miss, yes, miss, I will do it. Somehow, you know, she feels maybe threatened. She feels a sense of insecurity that this child knows too much. So here is a teacher who's trying to be very dominant and trying to put down this child. And poor Jia, all she's saying is that, yes, I'm good in spellings and I want to learn more and I want to contribute. But Sonal doesn't like it. So what happens? Let us see.
Don't show up every time in the class when I'm asked spellings, you have to raise your hand as if you know all the spellings in the world.
Yes, ma'am.
What? Yes, ma'am. You know all the spellings in the world?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. In that case, can you tell me how do you spell crocodile? Tell me how do you spell crocodile? This is the last time I'm telling you. Can you write and show me how do you spell crocodile?
Yes, ma'am.
You stupid girl. Finally, you made a fool of yourself. Crocodile is crocodile for you.
Ma'am, you asked me how do I spell crocodile, and this is how I do.
Wow. Hats off to Jia. What did she do? She didn't break down and start crying, saying that, oh, I made a fool of myself. I don't know the feeling, the spelling of crocodile and all that. On the other hand, she didn't get aggressive and say, ma'am, you have not taught us crocodile, so how do you expect me to spell it or something? She would have got into more trouble with that dominating teacher. So she's thought of a simple way around. Teacher was going on saying, write down, how do you spell crocodile? Write down, how do you spell crocodile? She picked up on that. And she wrote whatever she could. And when the teacher is scolding her, she said, ma'am, you asked me, write down, how do you spell crocodile? And this is how I spell crocodile, ma'am. Now see, the teacher is in a very awkward situation if this is happening in front of all the other children. Maybe a very short, maybe a funny anecdote, but this is what actually works. We do have to understand that if you, you know, understand it. At the same time, let me also caution you. Assertiveness also involves taking responsibility. You can't abdicate responsibility and yet expect other people to be nice to you and you be assertive with others and things of that sort. So I should understand that I am responsible for treating others fairly. I am responsible for my actions and their consequences. I'm responsible for even upholding other people's rights. If I uphold other people's rights, chances of their upholding my rights are a little higher. When I take decisions, I will stand by my decisions, whether it is right or wrong or whatever it is, and I will accept the responsibilities for my own thing. Now, finally, how do you build up this assertiveness? Whenever you are into any type of, you know, interaction which may be a little unpleasant or maybe a little difficult, first thing is calm down. Take a deep breath, relax, have a glass of water, prepare yourself, stretch out, be ready beforehand that yes, I am now going to be facing this situation. At the same time, don't anticipate trouble. Oh my God, now this boss is coming and he is definitely going to shout at me. I don't know what he will pick up, something or the other, he says. And the other people are watching and right, my juniors are here and this is the time he had to come. The moment you start that thought process, you cannot be assertive when the situation actually happens. So do not anticipate trouble. Replace your thoughts and say, okay, boss is coming. There's a possibility he can be nice to me. There's a possibility he may be rude to me. I have to face both of them. After all, he's my boss. I have to interact with him. I am making myself ready for that. Once you know that your mental state is ready, that is when I would like you to go turn back to the person and say, I would like this from you. I feel unhappy when this happens. I get more confused when someone shouts at me. You see the difference? Instead of saying, don't shout at me, you are shouting at me, it puts off the other person. But if you use I sentences, you can be much more assertive. I get very confused whenever somebody shouts at me. I get a little flustered when somebody rushes me in and makes me do 10 things at a time. I'd like to do it one thing at a time. I have a different opinion on this, I just want to be heard about what my opinion is, and then we can come to an understanding or to a consensus or whatever the thing. I'm getting mixed reactions. I'm not very sure whether this is the correct one or that is the correct one. When you start doing these sort of things, it helps. Same way, ask for feedback from the person. What is it that makes you angry? What is it that makes you unhappy? What is it that will make you happy? What exactly are you doing? So like, Meera told Sridhar, can you be a little more specific about what is it that is making you angry? That's all it takes. So simple things like that. And when you want to be assertive, put it down in just three parts. Describe the situation. When somebody is raising their voice, or when somebody starts pointing fingers at me, or when somebody you know, just criticizes me without clarifying what it is, first part. I feel, second part, I feel uncomfortable, confused, demotivated. Think of all the emotions which you actually feel. Practice them and keep them ready. So when this sort of a thing happens, I feel this. Back it up with, I would like this situation to change into this. I would be happy if we can sit down and discuss this. I would prefer if we put it down in writing so that it gives me time to think and it gives me clarity instead of both of us, you know, arguing or shouting at each other and things like that. These are, in a nutshell, some of these areas. I've also brought out a booklet on practicing different exercises on assertiveness and all that. You can have a look at that. You can order a copy online or something of that sort and go through in detail if you want to do those exercises. As I said, assertiveness takes a lot of time, effort, and exercise, but you can do that. Out of that, we had sent you, I hope many of you received it, we had sent you one exercise, you know, simple one. There we had asked you to rate yourself on a few points, how you normally behave. In that, you would have done it. Those of you who have done it, total up your score. So for one, you wrote, you know, 4. For another one, you wrote 1. For another one, you wrote 3. Whatever it is, for all those, you have given your rating. Now, when you total it up, I want you to check what your total is. I hope and wish your total was above 60, roughly, somewhere around 60 or more than that. You're a very assertive person. Hats off to you. Congratulations. You don't even have to attend this particular webinar, but you're doing it. I'm happy. Maybe you can help others with it. Somewhere in the region of 45, 50, 55, you know, if you've scored somewhere there, you're reasonably assertive. Maybe you can just give it a little boost, but nothing to worry. You're not, you know, losing out on life and relationships because of lack of assertiveness. Only if you have gone below that, you know, below 40, 45, if you have gone, then I think you should definitely wake up and do something about building your assertiveness. And I hope nobody got a score less than 30, because then you really need help. How that can be done, what it can be done, including some of the questions which have already started coming, we shall do that. As they say in the TV serials, break ke baad, I also need a cup of tea. I'll be back in a minute.
Hi, so I really wish I had known about these skills when I was a child. I had practiced it. So how can we help our children as responsible adults, as parents, as teachers? Imagine if we get this children to inculcate all these types of skills like assertiveness and many other life skills. Imagine what kind of adults they'll make. They'll know exactly how to express their feelings and emotions. So if you want to learn about, you know, this particular aspect, and if you want to be a better parent or a better teacher or anybody who deals with children, we have a certification course called CCAD, Certificate in Child and Adolescent Development. This time we are going online. It's starting on Monday. So if you are interested to understand children better, all the aspects, their holistic growth in every phase of their life from 0 to 18 years, it will cover life skills, you know, the importance of life skills, how to, you know, deal with their emotions, how to help them to deal with their emotions, how to help them to express their emotions, and many, many aspects of, you know, their growing up years. If we are able to guide our children and adolescents well, imagine, you know, what kind of an impact that will make in their life later on. So if you're interested in this program, please contact us immediately. It's starting on Monday, 7th of December. It's a 4-month online program. And every Monday, you'll have a classroom, a live classroom session. So from 10:30 to 12:30. And the best part about this program is it has a mentoring session.
So we will give you a mentor. There'll be a group of like 7-8 mentees and one mentor, and you'll have another session during the week other than the Monday, whatever is convenient, you know, conveniently decided between you and your mentor. You can all sit down together, you know, the 9-10 of you in a smaller group, sit down, brainstorm, go. Actually, you'll be given assignments, go speak to a child or speak to a pregnant woman and things like that. You will go and come back and brainstorm along with your you know, batchmates and classmates, and imagine what learning that will be to understand children better. So that is one thing. And the other thing is that you will have a review session every four or five classes, again bringing you the gist of the whole you know, different topics that are covered. Many topics will be covered in this, you know, to start off with the holistic development, like the cognitive, study skills, mental, emotional, physical, all side, you know, all aspects of development at various stages, parenting style, single parent, single child, adopted child, and several such topics. And later on, as the child reaches adolescence, the boy-girl relationship, sex education, and several such topics like career guidance or, you know, study skills. So this is a very, very holistic, amazing program. So if you're interested in understanding children and adolescents better, please contact us immediately and get started from Monday itself. So back to Dr. Ali.
Thank you, Meera. Glad I was assertive in asking for the break so that I can have my cup of tea. And let me see what are the questions. A lot of people have said good morning. So a collective good morning to each one of you. Neha says, in a fight between two people, if one person is being assertive, then how do you differentiate between being assertive and justifying themselves? Being assertive, part of being assertive is justifying yourself. But how you justify yourself is what we are discussing. You can justify yourself by being aggressive. Shut up. I am right. I know what I'm telling you. You don't have to tell me. That is also justifying. But that's not the right way of doing it. What we are talking about assertiveness is the means that you use to how to ask for your rights, how to ensure that you are not walked all over and people don't take advantage of you. Meera says, I find it very difficult to be assertive or say the right things to a person when he is shouting or upset or angry. My mind just stops working, especially with a relative or near and dear one. Yes, it happens to many of us who are non-violent and who are, you know, the types who don't want to get into all these things. Our culture, our upbringing has also been like that for most of us. So what do I do? Ask for time. I understand that you're angry. In that role play also, didn't you see? Meera said, yes, I understand that right now you are very angry. Can we discuss this a little later? By the time I'll finish, that maidservant has already come late. No, I want to make sure that food is cooked quickly and all that. I'll come back to it. Try to gain time. It may not be possible every time, but whenever possible, try to gain time. Or sometimes you can even gain time with the other person saying, yeah, I think what you are saying makes a lot of sense. Let me just think over it. I'll get back to you. The moment you have said that, I think it makes sense, the other person feels very happy that, okay, you are listening to me. When you come back, you can concede on some points. Yes, here I think what you were right. But there I think I need to differ and things of that sort. Yes, Madhvi says, I'm not assertive at this age also. What has age got to do with it, Madhvi? Please don't keep thinking about your age all the time. Even after 100 years, you can start becoming assertive if you take the trouble, learn the right techniques and start practicing. Venkatesh, score is 59. Excellent. I'm really happy for you. That's what I said, that people, you know, who have learned assertiveness. I'm really glad about that. I feel paralyzed when someone starts shouting or being confronted. Bharti says, yes, it's exactly the same as what, you know, Vinita also said. Some of us just cannot respond. Doesn't matter. Nothing happens. At that moment, as I told you, no, ask for time. Just say that I want just 1 minute. I'll just go to the washroom and come. Or I think Venu has brought a cup of tea. And I just want to have a cup of tea so that my mind gets a little clear. Then I will respond to you. At least learn that much assertiveness to be able to deflect that anger and that shouting for that minute. From there, you can proceed further. Yes, Sunita said that I get panic. It happens. All these are very common symptoms for most of us who are very peace-loving and, people who don't want to get into conflicts. But somewhere you cannot allow the other person to shout and dominate and all that. No? So we have to learn these things. How not to be defensive and be assertive. Yes, Naveena, that's exactly. The moment you are defensive, you cannot be assertive. No, what did I do wrong? No, this is the way. What can I do if the maidservant came late or something? The moment you do that, the other person knows that you are being defensive, you are apologizing, you are trying to get away from it. You should learn to control over the maidservant. Why do you have a maidservant who always comes late? No, she doesn't always come late. Today she has come late. Yeah, that's the excuse you'll give me. You get the point. So do not be defensive. Do not give excuses if you truly want to be assertive. I find myself in a fix, especially at workplace and with seniors or my boss, who tells me to do things that I do not wish to. And when I refuse, they hold it against me. Yes, Venkatesh, this is one of the very important techniques of assertiveness, which we call as how to say no. How to say no is first listen completely. Don't start off by interrupting and saying no. Person gets very angry. Oh, I see, you want me to do this. But can you explain, sir, what exactly do you mean? Which is this thing? Oh, I thought that work was to be done by Suresh. You want me to do it, is it? Okay, what happened? Let me do this. Keep putting the ball back in the other person's court and listening to him, asking him questions. Sometimes he himself will get caught in his own thing. No, that Suresh never listens to me and he does that. So why don't you just be a little firm with him and tell him also, because I've got other work. We can do that. So once you start doing that, then what happens is at the end of it, you say, I would like to think it over. Then you bring in saying, I have these three tasks to do. And now you're giving me this fourth task. I'm just seeing how it can be managed. It may take a lot of time. Yes, if I sit late in the night, I think I can complete it. But nowadays, my health is not permitting me to do that. I'm finding that my efficiency goes down. I'm making stupid mistakes if I sit late in the night, particularly when I'm hungry at dinner time and things of that sort. And finally, when you want to be assertive with somebody like your boss and all that, suggest alternatives. If you don't mind waiting for a few days, sir, I think next week I will reschedule some of my appointments, reduce the workload, and I'll do this. Or can I request Ramesh? I think he has some spare time. Let me see if he can join us and get this thing done. Can we split this job? Keep on exploring alternatives. Sanjay says, 13-year-old being partially aggressive, assertive at home, and submissive outside, is this normal? Yes, it is normal, but we need to do something about it, because this 13-year-old tomorrow is going to be facing a big bad world outside. So start teaching him how to become more and more assertive outside. Ask him what happened. No, when teacher says that, I panic or I get scared. When that bully comes and says something, I get this. Teach him these little techniques that I've been talking about, and there are many more. You know, if you could look into it, or if you could ask for that little booklet on assertiveness, there are a lot of these questions and this and that, which we can work on. Neha rightfully says, I feel a lot of courage is needed to be assertive. Yes. So build up your courage. Tell yourself that you have a right to be heard. You have a right to your dignity. You're as good a human being as anybody else and things of that sort. Take that deep breath. As I told you, build up your this thing. Bring down stress. If there are other things which are bothering you right now, I have to get that dinner done on time, or I have something else to do, or somebody is irritated. Resolve those issues before you face this sort of thing. Surek says, how can a boy be assertive with his father who keeps on demanding money for his gambling addiction, and if he does not oblige, then harasses his mother? So here is a person who's using blackmail tactics. You know, if you don't give me this money, I'm going to harass your mother. Now the boy obviously loves his mother and he doesn't want the mother to get offended. First, talk it out with the mother. When he harasses, how can you protect yourself? Between you and me, how can we become a team to become assertive between the two of us? Once he finds that his mother is a little more protected, then it becomes easier for him to face his father and be assertive in saying that this much I will give, this much. And remember that when a long-term relationship like a father and son, and if he has been giving him money for drinking, whatever it is, you can't one fine day become a hero and stop. It can lead to a very bad conflict. So start reducing it. Start giving some reasons and say, today I cannot give, or this week I cannot give, or I can give you only X rupees and not Y rupees or something. So they twist it around so that, you know, it doesn't lead to a conflict, and yet you get your purpose is can be, you know, served. Okay, Mamshi says, quick steps you can suggest to build. I have been giving you here and there and all that, but as I told you, within this short span, I can't give you too many tips. But the fact remains, I repeat again, listen completely to the person, do not interrupt, have a positive and a neutral expression on your face. Don't allow the other person to think that you're either getting scared or you're getting angry or something. Behave in a very neutral, calm, relaxed manner, have a glass of water, make eye contact properly with the person. After listening to everything, ask for clarifications. What you meant was this or that? Would you like this? Or why do you feel that I am doing this? Can you give me some examples of what happened? And then state your opinion saying, I think this. Or if necessary, even ask for time. Right now, I'm getting a little confused when you're asking me to do this. Give me a little bit of time. Vannika is asking, does self-esteem related to being assertive? Yes, very much, Vannika. You have to build up your self-esteem. If your self-esteem is low, it is extremely difficult for you to be assertive. So you have to make sure that your self-esteem is built up. Anjali says, sometimes people don't understand assertiveness and they try to impose their opinion on others and try to prove their point. Yes. In fact, I'd like to take it one step ahead of what Anjali said, that when you start being assertive, there is bound to be turbulence. If you have never been assertive or you've hardly been assertive and now you're building up your assertiveness, the other person doesn't like it. The other person has got used to you behaving in a submissive or aggressive manner. So be ready that initially there will be turmoil. There will be an escalation of the conflict situation. The other person will say, what is this nonsense? What are you doing? You have to remember that assertiveness pays in the long run. You're talking about building a relationship on a long term, not just winning some battle right now. That is what aggressiveness does. So if you're working on that, be ready for some turbulence, be ready for some more unpleasantness, but continue to be assertive. You know, in assertiveness, we used to use that technique. I think most of the people have forgotten. There used to be a gramophone record. And gramophone records, if there is a scratch on it, what used to happen was that the pin used to keep jumping back to the previous line. So we used to call that the broken record technique. Keep on repeating the same thing. I will not be in a position to do this. Somebody has asked, no, how to say no, I can't do it. Just say no without giving excuses. Somebody is asking you for money, which you don't want to give. Even if you have the money, you don't want to give. You just don't say, I don't have the money, because then that person will catch you online. Or will say, when you have it, I'll take it. I'll come on first of the month when you get your salary and I'll take it. Don't give excuses. Just say that I am not in a position to give it to you. I don't think I can oblige your request. Yeah, I know that you need the money and you came to me with a lot of expectations, but I cannot give it to you. Do not be apologetic about the thing. Meeta says, one more thing, some people think, because now I'm a counselor and I've got a green signal to be assertive, or am I misunderstood? Yeah, a lot of those things happen in families. Yeah, now you're a counselor, now you will advise everybody. Yes, you can read my mind now, you know, you're a psychologist, something of that sort. That's all temporary. Again, assertiveness demands that you say, it has nothing to do with being a counselor. You are important to me, I have this relationship with you, I like you, I love you. I want to improve on this, and that is the reason why I'm suggesting that we should do it in this way, so that there is minimum conflict and we come to a situation where you also feel satisfied and I also feel satisfied. Sakuntala said, I learned assertiveness from a fourth grade child when I went to his house, and he so politely told me, Auntie, please don't come inside. My parents have gone out and asked me to not allow anybody. It's only for our safety, Auntie. Wonderful. This is what I appreciate in parents who have helped a small child to learn this. Otherwise, any other child would be scared. How can I tell an auntie not to come? She will get angry or something of that sort. It takes a lot of training. And if you can start with children, no, nothing like it. The child will grow up into becoming a very assertive adult. Poonam says, my husband delays everything when we are going out, let it be anywhere, and argument starts as you delayed, how to deal with it. Now, this is a practical situation more than assertiveness. You have to look for situations how you can, at a practical level, avoid that thing of the delays. See that, you know, something is done, or see that, you know, you start off earlier than what is needed. Or sometimes it may also need to be assertive, saying that we have to leave at 10 o'clock because so-and-so is waiting. I cannot make that person wait. In case you're not ready at 10 o'clock, I think I will proceed. You can catch up later. Sometimes we even have to use such techniques to drive the point home. Navina says, how to handle the turbulence while trying to be assertive? How to keep yourself motivated to carry on being assertive? You have to understand the long-term implication. See, if I am hurt very badly, the surgeon will say, I'll cut you open and remove that tumor or this or whatever is embedded in your body. So it is going to increase my pain when he does the surgery, isn't it? But I know that the long-term effect is I want to heal. So here also, I want to heal my mind, and this turbulence is going to come in. And that's why I said, start off with reducing your stresses. Use whatever means and techniques to bring down your stress levels. Maybe have one or two good friends with whom you can, you know, cry out and tell that, see, I'm going through all this turbulence because I started being assertive. And that person will say, no, you're on the right track. Continue. We'll give you that support which is needed. Sharman says, be like a pope. Yeah, I know. We can work towards that also. Okay. What is the next question? Do we have any more?
You answered most of them, Ali.
Yeah.
So we are waiting for more questions now.
Okay. So let me also give you another couple of tips, like Mamshi was asking. That first thing, please also remember, you have to be convinced that assertiveness is the right means and I want to do it. Ask yourself, do I want it or not? If you are doing it only because somebody like Ali told you this is a good technique and it will work, it will not work. You will give up halfway through. So tell yourself that I have a right to my own needs and wants. I want to balance it. I don't want to get into conflict with somebody, but I'm not going to allow. I think this is an important thing and I have this need. Please convince yourself before you start off on this process of trying to be assertive with other people. Smita says, I've been observing that I can't be assertive most of the time with a couple of my immediate family members. I feel I'm being rude. Yes, it happens with all of us that one or two persons, we cannot be assertive. Generally, with others, I'm assertive, but with this person, I cannot be. Ask yourself the background. Was it because I'm scared of this person? Is it because this person is very angry and rude? Is it because I feel that I will lose out in something? So work that part of it out. When you know that you can be assertive and you are being assertive with others, why am I losing out on this particular person, these one or two people? There's inevitably, there is a background to it. If you go ahead and check that out and understand what is the background to it, and then slowly start building assertiveness. But if you can do it with those one or two people with whom you are not doing it, I can assure you that you will in future be able to be assertive with anybody who's trying to be oppressive or dominating or anything. So it's a skill which will last you your whole lifetime. That is what I keep emphasizing about assertiveness. These are some of the basic life skills which once you start practicing and getting into it, they help you on something like a lifelong basis. So you have to take out time and put in this effort. That's another funny thing that I come across people. Yeah, right. Yes, when you spoke, I felt very nice. Then I got that booklet also. I saw those exercises. I felt that I must do this. But you know, right now I'm very busy because we have this extra workload in the office. Right now it's difficult for me because, you know, I have this ongoing battle going on with so-and-so in my family and I'm very disturbed. That is the time when you need to practice more assertiveness. It's almost like saying, you know, I could not read the book on time management because I didn't have time to read it. The same thing happens with assertiveness. Navina says, I like the role modeling displayed. I learned how to address my and others' emotions and be assertive and learn that. Listen completely till the end. Hearty congratulations to Sridhar, Meera, Sonal, and little Gia, who played a wonderful part. We just, rehearsed her half a dozen times in a few minutes, and Gia managed it. So it shows that when she grows up also, she's going to be a very assertive adult as she grows up. This is the age to start off by teaching children, and that's how things go on a long-term basis. There are a few, assertiveness, mantras, if you can start practicing those. Some of them I had mentioned to you, you can keep adding to that. I have the right to say no. It's my life. I have something which I agree, something which I don't agree. I do not want people to dominate and tell me all the time what to do. So sometimes I have a right to say no. Including, I even mentioned that I have a right not to understand. I'm not a superhuman that you have explained. How stupid you are. I explained to you last time and you still don't get it. Yes, it is something unusual. It is something different for me. I'm not used to this sort of thing. So I agree what you're telling me that I did not understand. See, when you turn the tide onto the other person by saying, I agree, then the person cannot hit out at you. If you try to defend yourself, somebody had asked, no, and I said that don't ever try to be defensive. If you say, what do you mean I didn't understand? What is it that I didn't understand? The person can continuously be offensive and can keep putting you down and try to prove that you are going down. But if you accept and say that, yes, there are times when I don't understand. It may be because my mind is occupied with something. It may be because this is the first time that this is happening to me. It may be because I'm not trained or I'm not that highly qualified in this particular aspect of life. But I do want to understand. That is very important. Yes, Shirin rightly says, learn to say no in many languages. That's a wonderful thing. Maybe you can make a chart of all the Indian languages. Nahi, beda, vaddu. What all, I'm not a linguist, but I'm sure there are people, you can even start using that in your daily conversation so that, if the other person is not understanding, you can use 2-3 different language knows and get your message across to the person. But basically, what is needed? Again, I will, just for getting a reinforcement on that, I will repeat to you. If somebody is asking you to do something or, oblige on something which you have made up your mind, first make up your mind. I know a lot of people, for example, I know parents, when the child starts making unreasonable demands, they keep saying no, no, no. And at one point, they just buckle down and say, stupid fellow, all the time bothering me. Okay, take it and go. Please do not do that, whether it's a child, whether it's your boss, whether it's anybody for that matter. First, make up your mind, am I going to oblige this person on this or not? If I am convinced that I do not have to oblige, I do not want to oblige rather, I do not want to give this favor or this money or this gesture to this person, and I have reason enough to do it, that is when you start saying no. And exactly as Shirin said, you can say no in whatever language you can without backing it up with because of these. I want to give you the money, but you see, right now I have a commitment and I can't. What commitment? You want to spend money on other things and you don't want to give me on these. It starts off. If you learn to say plain, simple no and stick to it like that gramophone record I told you, that broken record type of thing, without getting angry, without getting aggressive, keep repeating. Practice, learn how to do it. It takes a lot of effort, but it does work in the long run. Shobha says, whenever I can't do something, he says, all the working women do, why can't you do what I respond? I had heard a very nice anecdote on where there was this mother who was trying to put down a child by saying that, you know, Lal Bahadur Shastri used to swim across a river and go 10 miles to go to school, and what's wrong with you, and why can't you do these? And the child turned to the mother and said, you know, at your age, Indira Gandhi had become the prime minister of the country. What have you achieved? Maybe it must have irked the mother. But simple way of getting across that, you know, you can't just compare me with others. I am me. If I start comparing you with others, you're also not going to like it. That is what you need to understand. Tell that person. Maybe all working women do it, whereas though I don't actually agree, because it can't be all working women. Maybe I'll agree that many working women do it, but I am me. I am different from others. So while winding up, let me again remind you that little exercise that we had given you to evaluate yourself. If you have done it truthfully, if you have done it in the proper way, if you have doubts, take the help of somebody who knows you very well and who's willing to be frank and, you know, forthright with you, and review that, am I doing this very often, frequently, or never, and all that. Make sure that you get your totaling correct. And I repeat again, those who have come close to 55, 60 and above, excellent. You don't have to worry. Those who are in that 45, 50 range and all that, you're still reasonably assertive. Maybe you can work towards building it up a little more. Those who are below 45, you know, 30, 35, 40, those sort of ranges, you need to do something. And if you are below 30, you are really making your life miserable by succumbing to others. Please learn to value your own life, and the world will learn to value you. It works that way. Please give yourself more importance. Please build up more of your self-esteem. Do not neglect yourself, and you will see that life becomes beautiful for you and for many others also around you. With that message, we wind up with always this message to all of you, that any time you feel after these programs any issues like this, please feel free to get in touch with us. We give free counseling in person. People are coming. We are fully functional Monday to Saturday. You can walk in over here if you want to. If you're a little apprehensive these days about going to places, you can talk to us on the phone, or you can send us an email. That gives us time to think over what the issue is and to reply to you. Systematically, we reply to all the mails that come to us, and it's a free service. It will be a pleasure to get back to you. Please, if you specifically want to mark a mail to me also, you can say that this is for Ali, and we will make sure that we respond to you. So have a wonderful and an assertive day, a good weekend, and a wonderful assertive life ahead. Thank you very much.
So thank you everyone for joining us today on this wonderful Saturday morning. Do join us next week, where Dr. Ali Khwaja will be talking about what makes life meaningful. And in conversation with him are many wonderful personalities who are here, who will be there to share their story. So see you around next Saturday. Bye-bye.